Greetings, hello, and welcome back to another Long War of the Chosen Class Guide, and this time we're gonna take a look at the Grenadier class. And I had some long thoughts about this whole thing and decided to just restrict it to two builds here that we're gonna be looking at. First one being the damage Grenadier. So first of all, let's talk about the role of the damage Grenadier. There's a slight hint in the name of the build that I call it, and for me this role is actually going to be doing damage to enemies. Secondary effect, of course, with your grenades you're going to be doing shredding, and you're going to be providing a little bit of control with status effects like burning, poison, etc., what you want to do. Now, what I'm leaving out of this is cover destruction, and you might also see that I have not put any sort of squares around Sapper and Combat Engineer here, the cover destruction perks. So before we jump on to into my reasoning for the different perks, we have to talk a little bit about environmental damage, cover destruction, how it works in the game, and why I feel it's too unreliable to actually include in the build here. Starting off the conclusion. Okay, so most cover objects in XCOM 2 have an environmental health value, so how much environmental hit points they have, and those values are usually 10 or 20. 10 is like most of the half cover objects, like park benches, little street signs, etc., and 20 is then for any full cover big walls, etc. It's not a rule that covers it all. You might have full cover objects that only have 10, and you might have very sturdy half cover, so it's very hard to say when you look at a cover object in the game whether or not it's 10 or 20. Most importantly, you need to destroy that environmental health with a single attack. Throwing multiple grenades at the same object just gives you a new roll to defeat that environmental health, so you don't damage it over time and with multiple grenades destroy it. You have the same chance with every single grenade to either destroy it or not destroy it. Now, destroying simply means you throw a grenade or rocket at it, and if the environmental damage you do is higher than the health that it has, congratulations, you destroyed it. There's also a little bit of some objects can be kind of downgraded. You might have seen a full cover wall getting reduced to a half cover wall and then later destroyed. How that exactly works, let's just say I'm not going to go into that because I actually don't know. Alright, so let's look at the actual values. Grenades. Your box standard frag grenades do environmental damage of 9. Now you might say, hang on, I destroyed cover objects with that. Yeah, you did, because there's also a variance to it. So when you do your attack, you can roll within minus 20 to plus 20% modifier on that, so 9 plus 20%. Congratulations, 10.8, that's more than 10, you destroyed a half cover object. So great. What about plasma grenades? Well, they also have an environmental damage of 9, because why would they be an upgrade? Unless, of course, a mutant throws it, then they have environmental damage of 10, because screw you, XCOM. Anyway, so then we have our little friend here, Sapper. Your explosives can destroy many cover objects. Well, what this does is gives you 3 additional points of environmental damage. So suddenly you're looking at 12 damage with your grenades, which should destroy all 10 health objects unless you roll minus 20%, because then it's XCOM baby, right? But you're not any closer or further away from destroying a 20 cover object, so it alone doesn't do anything. And Combat Engineer adds another 8 points of environmental damage on top of that. So if you have both perks, your grenades now do 20, exactly 20 environmental damage. So unless you roll a negative modifier on your variants, you actually destroy high cover walls, but even if it's just -1%, you're already screwed and the wall is looking healthy. So all of that combined, to me, just goes down to the conclusion of it's too unreliable, and if I want to destroy cover, I use a rocket. Basic rockets, first tier gauntlets do 20 environmental, second tier 25, tier 3 30. So, and Bunker Buster is like 125 environmental damage. So, it's, if you really need the cover destruction, don't rely on grenades. So that brings us to this damage Grenadier build. One of the big things which makes this in Long War of the Chosen a viable build compared to Long War 2 is the change to needle grenades. This used to be a very niche pick where it would just not destroy loot when you kill enemies, but it now also deals +1 bonus damage to unarmored enemies. And especially in the early game, that's a massive, massive boost and makes grenades really, really good as a killer, but it also scales fairly well towards the end game. Of course, there's the unarmored enemies kind of thing, so you kind of need to shred enemies first, but that's most of the time not a big issue. And there's a surprising high number of unarmored enemies, like all snake types, they don't get armor anywhere in the game. Many of the advent troops, there's a late game dark event that gives advent, all advent guys, 1 point of armor, but many of the troopers and officers and stuff don't have any armor unless that dark event rolls around. So next step, heavy ordnance. Extra free grenade in your grenade only slot, that's fantastic, that saves you some money in production, and it's just, well, if you want to deal damage, then it's kind of a obvious choice here compared to the rest. Boosted course, grenades do one additional damage, fantastic. There's this weird, yeah, let me just turn this off. Grenades have extra explosives, do one additional damage, but require special training to handle. I don't know what that means, but it says so right there. Staff Sergeant pick. Now, 10 warheads versus heat warheads. Let's start with 10 warheads. We talked a little bit about 10 warheads in the technical video, but in case you haven't seen it, so your grenades do full damage at the maximum extent of the area effect. That doesn't mean you do maximum damage, but you do your full damage range. Like a plasma grenade does 4 to 8 points of damage, +1 from boosted, +1 from needle, that's 6 to 10. Anywhere to any unit within the radius. If you don't have tandem warheads, units at the outer edges of your AoE would only do take a minimum damage of 1. Maximum damage remains 10, but it's then 1 to 10 instead of 6 to 10. So in this extreme example of a plasma grenade with both perks and unarmored enemies, right, we're looking at 8 average damage with tandem warheads, opposed to 5.5 without it. So it's on average a 2.5 damage boost. Of course, the damage falloff depends on the distance from the center, yada yada yada, and I'm being a little bit pro tandem biased here by including the +1 damage from needle grenades already. So let's give it a 1.5 to 2 points of damage that you're gaining by picking tandem warheads on average, right? Across every single target that you hit. It also has the advantage if you have the one enemy that needs to die, it needs its maximum damage. If you don't have tandem warheads, you kind of have to center the grenade on that one bad guy. If you do have tandem warheads, as long as he's anywhere within the AoE, that's great. Just throw it off. Heat, your grenades pierce 2 points of armor. So if you fire grenades at heavy armored enemies, you're gaining, well, 2 points of damage there, pretty much. And you shred one additional point of armor. Now, heat is of course completely useless if you're firing grenades at unarmored enemies, which needle grenades kinda steer you towards a little bit. And of course they lose value if you have enemies with just 1 point of armor, and even for enemies that have 2 points of armor, plasma grenades shred too, so the additional 1 point of shredding doesn't get into any effect until you come to enemies with 3 or more points of armor. And often, at least in my opinion, anything that has 3 or more points of armor probably gets shredded first by your gunner. Or maybe by a shredder gun or a shredstorm cannon or something. So my personal pick is tandem here for the more consistent damage for everything in my AoE. And I do see the point of heat warheads though. I just think that the way I tend to use grenades, and with the thought in the back of my head that I want to be using it more likely against unarmored enemies anyway, if I can, if I have that choice, I think this has the better value. A lot of people like to crap on tandem warheads all the time, but I think if you just look at the numbers, do it the math, and if you ever get a grenade and do 1 point of damage on the edge of your radius for a grenade that should be doing up to 10, you're going to be picking up 10 warheads. Biggest booms. Plus 3 damage, 50% chance to crit. Again, I'm just going to repeat what I said in the Rocketeer video. You cannot modify this crit chance in any way, shape, or form. So no get some, no hollow targeting, no mind merge, etc. It's always 50%, you cannot do anything about this. But you can also crit chosen with that, even though they have minus 200% crit chance. So it's like a weird crit roll. And plus 3 damage, so yeah, on average 1.5 points of damage to everything in your AoE, that's great. There is some people really then pick up sting grenades, even for a damage grenadier, because having a 50% chance to stun everything as opposed to 50% chance of doing plus 3 damage seems much better. But for me it's a matter of equipment slots. Like, if I have all these perks that affect damage grenades, why would I load up my equipment with non-damaging grenades? Like, that's just less damage that I'm dishing out. It's kind of a... Especially also then with the advanced priests, elite priests, really nerfing sting grenades in a way where my preference is biggest booms, I can see an argument for sting grenades. Just not a good one. Anyway. Moving on, volatile mix increases the area of effect by one tile. Especially great for fire grenades, fire bombs later on to make them affect more enemies. Combos very nice with tandem warheads because that extra radius you're getting is also getting the full damage. There is a little bit of an argument, well, no, actually there's no argument to be made. So Bombardier used to be 3 additional tiles of range. Back in the days, in the 1800s, it's just 2 additional tiles. If I can choose between throwing 2 tiles further or having 1 tile additional radius, I'd always go for the radius. Like, this is not enough of a gain here. Salvo allows you to throw your grenade and then take another action, and I'm gonna make a small case for Salvo if you want to go officer route. So I kind of rate this as a 2 out of 5 officer, as in the whole argument of, hey, at least officer gives you something to do when you either don't want to use grenades or you run out of grenades. And in that case, also, if you pick up salvo, you can like throw a grenade and then use your second action to use an officer ability. I think if your target though is to deal damage, then the bigger radius hitting more enemies is just more valuable. And yeah, and so and also then the officer rating, basically it comes down to me for the to the point of if there's that big turn where every action matters and where I need that command from my officer, I probably also need a grenade in that turn, so I'll be throwing a grenade. It's like I can't wait for that turn where I'm running out of grenades and then I can start being an officer. I need to be able to perform both tasks, and I don't think a damaged grenadier can do that. Alright, finally, Master Sergeant. Talked a little bit about Combat Engineer and why I don't think the whole Combat Engineer supper is a good choice. So that leaves us with full kit plus one additional grenade in the agility slot, which, you know, is usually two additional grenades, keeping yourself busy. Ghost Grenade can be like a niche choice if you have someone in your squad. Like, let's say you have fixed squads, you always run with the same people, and there's someone in there who can really dish out a lot of damage from stealth, like Shadow Strike, Saturation Fire, Gunner, or something like that. Giving them another shot at concealment might be useful. I still think, but that's so situational that that's not worth a blue box here. Stats-wise, let's be honest, a damaged grenadier will not be shooting much, so aim doesn't matter. You want to have some decent mobility because you have the extra grenade slot, which slows you down even further. On the other hand, you're probably going to be running with an SMG, so it's fine. It's, for me, like, really a damaged grenadier is what you get. It's like the leftovers get trained into damaged grenadiers. I probably, if it's something like a 13 mobility, then I would try to avoid it, but anything above that, you can make it work. Alright, let's have a quick look at equipment. So, again, this is late game stuff, right? Also, before we look at the equipment, I just want to point out, in this campaign here, this was, I think, the second highest kill count across the whole squad, the damaged grenadier. Just say that, yes, it is totally possible to deal some damage. Warsuit, the heavy weapons from your warsuit do combine, they take advantage of some of the grenadier perks, so definitely worth picking that up. Also gives you, you know, more stuff that you don't need an aim stat for to just shoot. Weapon is just gonna be your standard SMG with whatever leftover attachments you have. You might occasionally take a shot, no big deal. Grenade launcher, of course, well, the best grenade launcher you can afford. I don't think you should make it a priority to get the tier 3 launcher late game. It's a really nice quality of life upgrade. But if you strip for resources, the second tier grenade launcher is going to be just as fine. And then a loadout. In this case, again, I'm fully committing to the idea of the damaged grenadier. So plasma, incendiary bomb. There are, let's have a very quick look at the other offensive grenades, right? Gas grenades have a damage range of 1 to 3, so their minimum damage is already 1. If you want to run with gas grenades or also with acid, I'm not even sure if I have any acid grenades anywhere here. Come on, show me some acid. I never build acid grenades in this campaign. Okay, Acid grenades also have a minimum damage of 1. So, if you really want to run with acid and or gas grenades, because you like the additional shred, you like the debuffs, gas grenades are especially good against certain chosen, then that also might impact your decision whether or not you go for tandem warheads, because it's effectively useless for gas and acid grenades. Just keep that in mind. On the other end of the spectrum, if you run with EMP bombs, they don't have a damage range. That damage is much higher, so you lose much more from damage falloff there for EMPs. Other than that, again, the special grenade in the grenade slot, because it gets doubled by heavy ordnance, although once you're Master Sergeant and have full kit, it doesn't matter which slot you put stuff into. But early game, you want to have this to double dip on that. So yeah, that's my damage grenadier. And then we're going to take a look at the support grenadier. Right, so that brings us to the support grenadier. And when I think of a support grenadier, I always want to call it a support officer grenadier, because that's one of my first picks for an officer, which you can also see, my officer, completely unbiased officer rating of 5 out of 5. They make good officer candidates, and I'm gonna explain in a second why. But let's go through the individual choices. Well, rapid deployment allows you to get a free action to deploy a support grenade. It's important to note support grenades are flashbangs, smoke grenades. The frost grenade counts as a support grenade, as do shape charges. And I think that's all the support grenades there. So you can deploy them as a free action, which combos really nicely with the whole officer thing of, you know, having contributing to a fight in a meaningful manner by throwing a flashbang at a bunch of enemies and then still commanding someone else, for example. My choice on corporal level is heavy ordnance, because even though they are support grenadier, I usually give them a fire grenade or a offensive grenade in the slot, because not every problem can be solved with a support grenade, especially late game when you're running into advanced or elite priests. They have, like, especially the elite priests have the aura that makes everybody immune to disorient and stun effects. So shutting them down with a fire grenade is probably your only course of action, because your flashbangs are going to be useless against anything else. So that's why I kind of like heavy ordnance. There is an argument to be made for protector. Most importantly, if you're running with the frost grenade from the Alien Hunters DLC, getting a second charge out of freeze is huge. Freezing an enemy group is just gonna mean automatically win the fight against that group. Personally, in my campaigns, I don't use the freeze grenade except if I'm running into rulers, so I'm kind of restricting myself because I think it's too strong and too unbalancing for the game. But play however the way you want, and if you're playing and actively using a lot the freeze grenade, get protector, get a second charge. It's gonna be probably the most useful thing you can do with this perk. That usually means, though, only one of your support grenadiers, if you build multiple, gets protector, because you only have one freeze grenade. Unless you run with a bunch of other mods, but then that's probably outside the scope of this guide. Now, moving on. Blue screen bombs. Flashbang grenades disorient robotic enemies and reduce their resistance tracking. That also means, I think, that robots will not use their missiles if they're disoriented, which is great. The hack resistance is nice for your specialists, But as far as I know, you need blue screen bombs so that sting grenades, which we come to in a second, actually affect robotic enemies. Let's actually just immediately talk about sting grenades. 50% chance to stun enemies in the area of effect of flashbangs. So any enemy you hit, 50% chance to just get outright stunned for a full turn. There are some late game enemies that have flashbang resistance, like Muton Elites, Advent Generals, and some other dudes. They can resist flashbang effects, they will not get disoriented. This does not affect sting grenades. Sting grenades are always going to be a 50% chance. And again, with, unless I'm completely mistaken, and please put it in a comment and I will, with some proof, and I will pin it. You need blue screen so that robotics are affected by sting grenades, and having a 50% chance to just outright stun a gatekeeper, a sector pod. Well, gatekeeper is not robotic. Sector pod, super heavy mech, etc. can save you your bacon. So, yeah, I'm not sure if I made it clear. Sting grenades is pretty good. Now, here's an interesting thing coming back to the Staff Sergeant role. And after much deliberation, I decided to not mark anything. So let me tell you why, and then I'll tell you why I picked heat wards here. So let's start at the bottom. Dense smoke. Smoke grenades get 10 additional defense. It's not your good old Long War 1 smoke where you get 20 additional defense, because that was broken as hell. For me, dense smoke is most often not a pick simply because of inventory slots. I only have 3 slots for grenades. One is taken off by my offensive fire grenade here. So that means I only bring then 2 flashbangs until I get full kit. If I replace one of those flashbangs by a smoke grenade, then I'm only having a single flashbang. That's not gonna last for any sort of mission. For me, dense smoke is kind of only a pick if I get a free smoke grenade here in the XCOM role. Or maybe if I get a free flashbang, and then I'm more happy to replace one of my flashbangs. Usually though, I'd rather have more flashbangs, as in then more sting grenades later on. Tandem warheads might be nice, like, you know, the fire grenades does 4 to 8 damage, so that's actually a big range. So if you have damage fall off, that's only 1 to 8, so you're actually getting some damage out of it. Then again, for a fire grenade, you really only care about setting the enemy on fire. You don't care if it does 2 or 7 damage initially, like, you just want to have them controlled. So I don't think it's a huge thing. Also, fire grenades have a ridiculously small radius anyway, so the distance to the center is not that significant. And then heat warheads. So if, like in my case here, I'm running with fire grenade, fire damage already ignores armor. Fire grenades do not shred armor, so I'm also not shredding an additional point of armor, because you need to shred one to begin with to shred additional points. So it's really not doing anything. The reason I have it here in this specific case is, once again, in that squad I was running fairly fixed squads. I had a specialist with airdrop that gives me some plasma grenades. Suddenly heat warheads is actually really useful for shredding and for, well, the armor pierce. So overall though, Staff Sergeant is a fairly disappointing role to pick up anything really. We already talked about sting grenades, but sting grenades are really good. Pick sting grenades for your support grenadiers. Gunnery Sergeant. Salvo is my pick with the whole officer situation in mind. Like, once again, it gives me, one rapid deployment is on cooldown, it gives me the option to launch a grenade, contribute in a meaningful manner to the fight, and then still command or do another officer ability. You can also combine the two. You can rapid deployment one grenade, salvo another grenade, or a heavy weapon, and then you still have an action to command. That's just fantastic action economy, and really combos nice with officer perks. There is still a good argument to be made for volatile mix. More radius is always more better. Though flashbangs and that way sting grenades already have a huge radius, so I don't think it's that needed. It does give a nice increase though to freeze grenades if you're using them, and of course to any fire grenades. Like these really get a lot of value out of volatile mix. But then you're giving up action economy for your officer abilities. So I'm kind of at viewer's discretion here. It's my preference is salvo just for the really always being able to command somebody. And more often than not, I'd rather run out of commands, and that's not something that happens too often with your officers. Finally, as before, full kit. More grenades is more better. Once again, if you have someone who really wants to be in concealment, then picking up ghost grenade is a choice, but you're giving up two grenades otherwise, so it has to be really, really worth it. Right, let's hide that and have a quick look at equipment. There's not too many changes. Again, warsuit combos nice with the with several grenade perks. Most importantly, you can launch your shredder gun from the warsuit with salvo, so it does not end your turn. In this specific case, I'm running with an assault rifle because I actually had a fairly high aim rookie promoted to grenadier here. And then I actually went all in, even gave him perception PCS, since he's an officer, to get the whole lead by example, giving additional aim to everybody in his vicinity, right? So he usually provides like 5 to 10 aim to others in the squad, which is it's nice to have. I wouldn't make it a priority. I wouldn't say take your high aim rookies and train them to be grenadiers, but you know, if you get one of those, then you get even extra bonus out of the whole officer side of things. And yeah, then grenade slots is gonna be double flashbang incendiary. I think that makes the most sense. There are some situations where you might want to roll with a gas grenade. Again, the assassin, as one of the chosen, is really vulnerable to that, and being able to slow her down is really nice. And then also the whole alien rulers thing and picking up a frost grenade can come in handy. There might be a situation where you can even consider for like a longer mission to throw out your plating and get even more grenades. Like these also get doubled by full kit. Personally, I think that's a little bit too risky. It kind of depends then on your soldier health, I would say. Alright, enough about that. Let's have a quick look in the wiki on the XCOM role perks, and then we can talk about those. Be right back. Alright, looking at the XCOM role perks for Grenadiers here. So we're gonna make it slightly different from previous encounters here, simply because I don't want to go through every single perk, so I'd rather point out those that I would say are instant pickups, and point out those that might be confusing or might be perks that you really want to avoid. So, talking about instant pickups, bring them on. For your damage grenadiers, amazing value. Again, 50% flat out chance to crit on every enemy, and you get extra damage then, especially if you use it on as an opener. Let's say on a rainbow pot of 8 enemies, you gain +4 damage on each one that you crit, so it's just really, really good. That damage grenadier that you saw in the first part of the video had to bring him on, and that's probably also contributing to that super high kill count. Then let me just scroll quickly through. There was where are you? Deep cover is kind of nice because if you did not attack this turn, hunker down. I'm fairly certain that grenade throwing does not count as an attack, if I remember my experience in the last campaign correctly. So that is almost always a hunker down. That keeps your grenadiers really, really safe. Hollow targeting is a good pickup because at least if you're not throwing a grenade, you can contribute a little bit with. Well, hollow targeting enemies, even if you have crappy aim, you just shoot in the general direction. I want to say in that regard, most of the time you probably have spare AP because there's not many that many good perks for your grenadier to pick up. Like most of the stuff doesn't combine with grenade abilities anyway, and you're not going to be shooting much, so the shooty perks are kind of meh. So lots of stuff situational. Shredder can be nice if you have halfway decent aim. Lightning reflexes is always good to pick up. More people with lightning reflexes is good. The free grenade perks are you most of the time automatic pickups, smoker and flashbanger, more so for your support grenadier. I'd say the damage grenadier doesn't get too much value out of it, but if you have the spare AP, sure, take it. Watch them run, I think it's not worth the 40 AP. Like, you'd think automatic overwatch after throwing a grenade, that sounds really good for a grenadier, but if you don't have high aim anyway, then it's kind of pointless. Like, you know, what did our damage grenadier have? 77 aim with an SMG on Overwatch. That's like 30% chance to hit against late game enemies with high defense. It's not worth 40 points. There's actually fairly few things that are worth any more points here. Maybe. I'm not even sure implacable. You might get a few kills with a damage grenadier, so that's worth it. Let's just look at some that might seem great, but are actually trap picks. And I would say aggression is one of those. As I mentioned a few times, you cannot modify the crit chance of biggest booms, so aggression does not make your grenades crit more often. It's only for your weapon attacks, and you're not going to be doing that often. Similarly, if you don't pay attention to the tooltip of Apex Predator, you might, hey, critical hits, panic nearby enemies. That's great, you know, I'm critting four enemies with the grenade. No, critical hits with your primary weapon. Your grenade launcher is not your primary weapon. So Apex is also a trap. Don't pick it with your grenadier. It's again, there's not many super great picks that I want to point out. Like, strong perks are also going to be strong here. There's a lot of middle of the road perks where, like, yeah, sure, if you have spare AP, soldier AP, not XCOM AP, pick up some stuff that maybe makes you shoot a little bit stronger or shoot twice or whatever, but it's nothing here is really a priority outside of bring him on from a damage grenadier and extra grenade perks for a support grenadier. And you know, 40 by is always a good choice. Alright, that's it for the XCOM row. And that's it for the grenadier. Well, I'm still taking suggestions for the next classes, although I know a lot of people said, hey, we want to see the gunner. So gunner is probably going to be one of the next ones. Well, certainly within the next 10 classes. Anyway, enough for today. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.